the souls of marhumin. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. In continuation with our explanation of Dua Kumail, last week we have talked about different kinds of sins, and we mentioned the effect according to the series or the sequence that Imam Ali mentioned in Dua Kumail. But before we go to tonight's session that we will be talking about, which relates to last week's discussion, and that is in references of tawbah, or asking Allah's forgiveness, there is a question or debate among our scholars, and that is, when I'm doing tawbah, asking Allah's forgiveness, do I have to mention every sin that I know and then do the tawbah and ask Allah for all those sins? Or no, I can just go and say, oh Allah, forgive all my sins. Which one is the practical and acceptable one in Islam? This is the debate. Some scholars believe that you have to go individually, one by one, mention them. And that is why Imam Ali in Dua Kumail, he mentioned them. Allahumma ghafir li al-dhunub allati tunzilu al-niqam. Allah, he was specifying them one after the other. That is some group of scholars. And those scholars, they have proofs from the Quran too. That when you go to the Quran, there are certain verses Allah spoke to certain people asking them to repent in certain sin they committed. That is number one. Number two, then some scholars say, no, you don't have to go into every one of those sins. You can generalize by asking Allah that the entire sin should be forgiven. Now, what is the majority of our scholars say about this? The answer is, either one is accepted in Islam. Either one. If you want to go and specify everyone, it's good. If you want to generalize all the sin and ask Allah's forgiveness, that is also accepted too. And you see, both of these is done in Dua Kumail. Now, look in the Dua Kumail. When Imam Ali specifies some, at the end he says, Allahumma ghafir li kull dhanbin adhnabtu. Oh Allah, forgive me every sin. Now he goes to generalize all the sin. So for that matter, we are allowed in Islam to mention the sins one by one and also to generalize them if you choose to. That is the point that I want to mention. But then today's session, we want to start from where Imam Ali alayhi salam is saying, is talking to Allah, Allahumma inni la ajidu li dhunubi ghafira. In just this tweet, this sentence, Imam Ali mentioning three things that nobody can do except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter how big a person can be. It doesn't matter how great that person can be. He or she cannot do it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are those three things? He said, Allahumma inni la ajidu li dhunubi ghafira. Nobody can forgive any sins except Allah. Somebody can intervene between you and Allah and do tawassul, but they cannot forgive the sin. The only one who forgives is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you can see in the Quran, in Surah Yusuf, when the children of Yaqub, after they did all the sin, they punished their brother, Yusuf alayhi salam, after they realized their mistake. Now listen, when they came to Yaqub alayhi salam, And they ask Yaqub, say, Ya Aba Nastaghfir Lana. Our father, ask Allah for forgiveness. Istaghfir Lana, seek for forgiveness for us. Now listen to Yaqub in the Quran. How did he respond to them? His answer was, Sawfa astaghfiru lakum rabbi. I will ask Allah to forgive you on your behalf. Meaning, he is not telling them, okay, even though the sin was done towards me, even though you are the one who hurt me, but he said that at the end of the day, Allah is the one who forgives everything. That is number one. Number two, وَلَا لِقَبَائِحِ سَاتِرًا. Nobody else can hide your sin other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we commit sin, Allah can expose us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He always tries to hide our sins from other people. How? Many things, many ways. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He hides the sin by not making you to be exposed to the others while the sin is committed. That is among humans. And also even in the Sidratul Muntaha, in the seventh heaven, Allah still covers you from the angels. You know, the narration says, when we are committing sin, our image exposed to the angels. They see. When a person is lying, the image exposed in the heaven, they can see him lying. And the entire angels, they will come looking at that person. Then Allah subhanahu, there are two narrations. One narration says, then Allah tells Jibreel to cover that image from the angels. Some narrations say, no, what Allah does is to turn the light off from that person so they can't see whatever sin he's committing. And that is why in dua, we say, Ya man satara al-qabih wa zahara al-jameel. He who covers the evil, the sin, and also display the good. That is number two. So number two, nobody can hide sin except Allah. That is number two. Number three, وَلَا لِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عَمَلِيَ الْقَبِيحِ بِالْحَسَنِ مُبَدِّلًا غَيْرًا. Nobody can turn our bad deeds to good deeds. Any sin that you commit, no human being can say, I'm going to turn the bad deeds into good deeds except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in surah, in one of the surahs, Allah clearly, Allah explained that if my servant sincerely repent to Allah and ask Allah for forgiveness, Allah said, not only I forgive him or her, Allah said, what I do extra is to take all the bad deeds, turn them into good deeds, and then put them into his good deeds. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتِ. That is one of the great rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For that matter, you can tell from this the three things Imam Ali's mentioned. He said, I cannot find anybody in the world who can do these three things beside you, Ya Allah. Allahumma la ajid. I can't find anybody. There are certain things some people can do for you, but these three things, Imam Ali said, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does. Then he says, La ilaha illa ant. There is no God but you. And that is also one of the most powerful sentences in the Quran or in Islam. This is the sentence that when you call upon Allah, Allah never rejects you. And you can see that also Nabi Allah Yunus alayhi salam in dua in the Quran, when you call upon Allah, that is his sentence. فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَلَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. That is the sentence. That is the call that he did to Allah. And Allah responded to him. Here Imam Ali is using the same thing. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. And we mentioned that there are three powerful sentences similar to this. that anytime you call upon Allah, Allah never rejects you. One is this, La ilaha illa anta. The second one, La ilaha illa huwa. The third one, La ilaha illa Allah. These three sentences, anytime you mention them, Allah never rejects you. And you, when you look at each one of them, they have their power. For example, La ilaha illa huwa, you look, it's the first sentence in Ayatul Kursi. And Ayatul Kursi is the most powerful ayah in the Quran. Number two, when you say La ilaha illallah, is the powerful sentence that can turn somebody from kafir to become a mu'min. A person is najis, is kafir. Now, as soon as he says this sentence, now it purifies them and takes them from their impurity to purity. That is the sentence, La ilaha illallah. And more than that, La ilaha illa ant also is the sentence that Allah say, when you call upon me with this, Allah never rejects you. That's the sentence. So Imam Ali continues to say, Subhanaka, glory be to you, wa bihamdik, and glory be to your praise. And then he said, Zalamtu nafsi. Here in Dua Kumail, usually we repeat this three times. Zalamtu nafsi, zalamtu nafsi, zalamtu nafsi. Meaning, I have oppressed myself. See, in Islam, there are three kinds of oppression. There is oppression, which is self-oppression. When a person commits a sin, he is not oppressing nobody but himself. Any sin that you can commit, any sin we commit, we are oppressing ourselves. And that's why you see in the Quran, when Adam alayhi salam, he and his wife, after they committed the eating the tree, they both said, Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. They say, we have done oppression to ourselves. That is the first one. It's self-oppression. Number two is to oppress other creatures of Allah. Somebody I know, I go and take something from them, I oppress them, I take their right. It's called dhulmul ghayr, oppressing others. That is number two. But then there is the biggest oppression, bigger than these two, and that is to oppress Allah. Oppress Allah? Yes, sometimes we oppress Allah. How can we oppress Allah? Allah mentioned in the Quran that sometimes you and I, we oppress Him. How do we oppress Allah? When you and I associate Allah with something, it's called oppression towards Allah. And Allah mentioned in Surah Luqman, Ya bunayya la tushrik billah, inna shirka la dhulmun azim. Luqman is telling his son, my son, do not associate Allah with anything. Why? Because when you do so, you are committing a great oppression towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are three oppressions. But sometimes we only think about one. We only think when I oppress someone, but I don't think oppressing myself. Because anytime you do and we commit sin, we are oppressing ourselves. Why? Because we are the same people who have to pay the consequence of it. Yourself is the one who will pay the price of it. Last week we mentioned about Adam alayhi salam. Today let me mention about one of the prophets also. He didn't commit sin. All he did was what? Tark babul awla. And see what Allah did to him just because of that. One of them is Yunus alayhi salam. Yunus alayhi salam, when he was sent to his people, and Quran mentioned, wa arsalnahu ila mi'ati alfin aw yazidun, to a people that almost like 100,000. Now he went there, he was preaching, calling them to Allah, the people would not respond. He decided, I'm going to leave. He left. Prophet Yunus alayhi salam didn't commit sin. Now what happened to him after he left? Now listen to the to this action and the result of it. Quran says, فَالْتَقَمَهُ الْحُوتُ وَهُوَ مُلِيمٌ. Allah said, now he has to pay the price. And what was the price? he has to be swallowed by the whale in the river. And Allah said, we place him in three darknesses. What are the three darknesses? Number one, Allah said, the darkness of the bottom of the river. It is dark. Nobody can see under the bottom of the water. He was in there. That is one. Number two, the darkness of the stomach of the whale. Number three, the darkness of the night when the night comes. And he was in this. Now, who is the one paying the price? Him, Yunus alayhi salam. Now, if this is tark al-awla, and this is the price he has to pay, now what about the sin itself? That is Adam alayhi salam. Number two, another prophet in the Quran, Yaqub alayhi salam, also did tark bab al-awla. And what happened? He has to be separated from his son that he loved the most for so many years. Lost his sight. Not because he committed a sin. It's just he left something that he shouldn't have left. Two things. One is the best. One is the good. But he chose to go to the good instead of the best. And he has to pay this price. Now what about the sin? That is one of the danger of sin, brothers. This is all from the Prophet. In the Quran, Allah tells you, they pay the price, not because they committed a sin, it's because of certain little things they did, and this is the price. That is why it's very dangerous. When we commit sin, Imam Ali called, ظَلَمْتُ nafsi. We are doing oppression to ourselves, not to Allah or to anybody. That is that part. The second part, then you go, Imam Ali goes to talk to Allah. He said, وَكَدَ أَتَيْتُكَ يَا إِلَهِ. After all these sins, after I did the injustice to myself. Now here, remember, then he says, وَكَدَ أَتَيْتُكَ. Now I come back to you. Imam Ali, we mentioned that tawbah means what? Returning to Allah. Because when we commit sin, it creates distance between us and Allah. And the more sin you commit, the more distance it creates. And the distance is amazing, brothers and sisters. Sometimes the distance that the sin creates, sometimes it might leave you a room to see Allah and come back. But if the distance becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, it might get to a certain point you can't even see Allah subhanahu. And that is the most dangerous part. Because when a person gets that part, he or she will never ever repent unless they die in that action. That is, when you get that part, that's it. There is no room for repentance. That's it. But if the person is lucky enough, before it got to that far, and they see Allah, and they started to return to Allah, that's what we call it a tawbah. Now Imam Ali said, وَكَدْ أَتَيْتُكَ. Now I realize the mistake. I realize the sin. Now I'm coming back to you, Ya Allah. But now the question, how do you come back to Allah? Here there are two people, three group of people. Some of us, we think that when I commit a sin, I can just wake up one night and say, Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayhi. And that's it. All my sins are gone. Some people, they say, no, I'm going to wait until I become like 95, 100 years. When I know that I'm very close to death, then I take one tasbih. I say, Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayhi. That's it. My sins are all gone. I'm ready to go to meet Allah. Done deal. Is that what it is? That I can commit sin as much as I want, and the last moment I say Astaghfirullah and he take care of everything. No, that's not what it is. It doesn't work that way in Islam. No. You have to go through certain stages of repentance for Allah to accept your tawbah. And that's what Imam Ali is telling us in this dua. He said, وَكَدْ أَتَيْتُكَ يَا إِلَهِ. He said, I return back to you, O my Lord. بعد تقصيري. And then he mentioned almost nine points. Number one, تقصيري وإسرافي على نفسي معتذرا نادما منكسرا مستقيلا مستغفرا منيبا مقرا مذئنا معترفا. Nine things while you're going back to Allah. you have to go through each one of them. That is one of the process of Tawbah. So Tawbah is not like, no, I just committed sin and that's it. No, it has to go through certain stages. Imam Ali mentioned 9 of them. But before that, he said, Ba'da taqsiri. At-taqsir in Arabic means shortcoming. I'm returning back to you, Ya Allah, after my shortcoming. Wa israfi. Here, think about these words that Imam Ali is using. Imam Ali alayhi salam used taqsir and israf. Now, what is the difference between taqsir and israf? Tafsir and israf is to commit certain mistakes that can cause someone to die from that. That's called israf. Now, the taqsir is that, no, it's a sin that I commit, but it might not be that bad. But Imam Ali combined both. He said, taqsiri wa israfi ala nafsi. That I'm coming back to you, O Allah, after committing some sins, which might not be so major, and plus the ones that might be a major that can lead me to perish. And then he mentioned also here a good important point. Ala nafsi, that each one of these is returning back to me. So whenever we commit sin, we have to remember about ourselves, not Allah. Any sin that we commit, yes, it's crossing the border on the line of Allah. But at the end, you are hurting yourself. Not Allah, not the Prophet, nobody except yourself. And that is the point Imam Ali said. And then as I come back to you, I have to meet certain situation as I'm facing Allah. Out of the 9, the first one, Imam Ali said, mu'tadhiran. Mu'tadhir, from the word i'tidhar. I'm coming back with what I did with some excuse, Ya Rabbal Alam. I ask you to excuse me from whatever I've done. I'tidhar, from the word udhur. Udhur means excuse. Mu'tadhir means I'm coming back to you with an excuse. What is the excuse here? Imam Ali explained in another part. He said, jahl, my ignorance is my excuse. Because had I known, I wouldn't commit these sins. That is number one. Mu'tadhir. So while we're going back to Allah for asking for forgiveness, you have to have excuse that you are going to tell to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's number one. Number two, nadiman, you have to regret about the past. It's very important. And you go to Najil Balagha, when Imam Ali, the same Imam, when he mentioned the condition of Tawbah, one of them is nadam ala ma mada. You have to feel a regret about the past. Because some of us, mashallah, when we commit sin, not only we don't regret, we even feel good about it. We come in the public and we talk about it and we brag about the sin. We want to feel good for committing sin instead of hiding it and keeping it between Allah subhanahu. Because you know, brothers and sisters, even sin that we commit, if I commit sin in the private, just between me and Allah, you know, forgiving, Allah forgive that much easier than the sin that I commit in the public and then brag about it in the public as well. And you know, the worst sin is the sin that I commit between me and Allah and then come out to let everybody know that I commit the sin. That is the worst. Because Allah, when you and I commit sin in private, Allah covered you. Nobody saw it. Nobody knows about it. Allah said, I want you to talk to me in private and I will forgive you. And that is the same story that happened with a lady called Al-Ghamidiyya. And this story is mentioned twice in the history. One time it happened at the time of the Prophet, and the same story also happened at the time of Imam Ali. A lady came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have committed zina and I want you to purify me. Purify here doesn't mean I need lashes for the zina. And she was pregnant at that time. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned his face, acted like he didn't hear what she said. She came to Anas, Ya Rasulullah, inni zanayt tahirni. Ya Rasulullah, I've committed haram. I want you to purify me by punishing me according to the Quran and the law of Allah. The Prophet turned his face another side. Three times he came. Then the Prophet looked at it. He said, if we have to punish you for the crime that you committed, but what is the crime of the baby you carry? Then the Prophet said, go and get the baby and give birth, and then come after that. She left. 9 months later, here she comes with the baby. Ya Rasulullah, this is my baby. I'm here for you to do the hajj of Allah, punishment of Allah. The same thing the Prophet turned his face. Three times, Ya Rasulullah, I came. This is the baby. Now go ahead and do the hajj. The Prophet turned three times, the third time, the Prophet said, if we have to punish you, now who is going to take care of this child? Do you have anybody? She said, no, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet said, take the baby, take care of him until he reached the age of 7. She took the baby, she left. After 7 years, she came back again. Allahu Akbar. Ya Rasulullah, he's 7. Then the Prophet said to her, Ya Amat Allah, O the servant of Allah, Allah loves when a haram is committed in private to be asked for forgiveness in private as well. Why do you come and ask in this public about Allah's punishment? But for Imam Ali, the same story for Imam Ali. When the lady came after 7 years, the man was there, a munafiq. He looked at Imam Ali. He said to Imam Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'minin, ila mata tu'attil hudud Allah? Till when you're going to keep postponing the law of Allah? The munafiq was telling Imam Ali. And Imam Ali alayhi salam look at him and he says, am I postponing the law of Allah or you don't understand the law of Allah? Then Imam Ali said, if you say I'm postponing the law of Allah, now you are obligated by the Sharia, by Islamic law, that you have to take care of this child of hers and then we can go ahead and take care of her. That is the rule. That in Islam, when haram is committed, Allah wants you between you and him. And you know the best time of tawbah is at night when everybody is asleep. Between you and Allah, 2 rakah prayer is called Salat al-Tawbah. In your sajda, between you and Allah, tell Allah how much you regret and how much you are sad about the sin and ask him to forgive you. And I guarantee you Allah will forgive. That is one of the conditions. That Imam says, Nadiman, you have to be in regret. Number 3, Munkasiran, you have to have a broken heart. Al-Inkisar, it means breaking something. But here, you have to have internally feel that I am really sad and my heart is broken for crossing the line of Allah. That is number 3. Number 4, mustaqila. Mustaqil, meaning I am here putting myself very low in front of Allah. Istiqala, meaning I'm here withdrawing myself from that position that I was in, where I was thinking about shaitan and committing sin. Now I left that position. Now I am being a true servant of yours. That is number 4. Number 5, mustaghfiran, seeking your forgiveness. Number 6, muniban, returning back to you. Muqirran, and I am conversing. Mudhinan, I'm agreeing from inside. And mu'tarifan, also I know for sure that I am a bad servant. All this, Imam Ali said, you have to confess in front of Allah. But you know what is amazing? Imam Ali mentioned some of these things that Imam Ali mentioned out of the 9. Some of them, it has to be internally, and some of them, it has to be shown outside. 2 of them, which is called an-nadama. When somebody regrets, it's internal issue. When somebody has a broken heart, it's internally. Right? But when you come, mu'tarifan, you have to say it out loud to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muqirran, when you confess, also you have to say it to Allah. Ya Allah, I confess, I am this. And you go to Dua al-Ayom Arafah for Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that our Hajjis, they read in Hajj. It's amazing how Imam Ali puts it. First, what he, Imam Hussein, first what he does is to mention all the blessing of Allah. أنت الذي هديت أنت الذي رزقت أنت الذي أطعمت أنت الذي أعطيت. He mentioned all the blessing of Allah. Then the second part, he talks about how bad servant we are. أنا الذي ظلمت أنا الذي تجاوزت أنا. Then he goes to talk about how bad we are. That is part of these things. For that matter, they said, in other our teeth in Islam, our scholars, they mentioned that a tawbah or repentance, it has to come through five stages. Five stages of tawbah. Stage number one, they call it at-tawbatu min al-kufri ila al-iman. Repentance from disbelieving to become a believer. That is number one. Number two, they call it at-tawbatu min al-iman al-mawruth al-taqlidi ila al-iman al-haqiqi. Meaning the second tawbah is to repent from the weak iman to the strongest and the real iman. That is number two. Number three, they say at-tawbatu min al-dhunub al-kaba'ir. Repenting from the major sins. Number four, they say at-tawbatu fi dhunub as-sagha'ir. You repent from the minor sins as well. Number five, they say at-tawbatu min at-tafakkuri anil ma'si. You repent from even thinking of sin. Allahu Akbar. Now let me share with you these brothers and sisters. See, the first way is called Nafsul Ammaratu Bisu. This is the first way. That if a person is doing these two, number one, At-tawbah min al-kufr ila al-iman, At-tawbah min al-iman min al-iman al-taqlidi ila al-iman al-haqiqi. That's two. Number three, min al-dhunub al-kabair is called al-maqam al-nafsul ammar bisu. It's the soul where the soul is doing everything to death to push you for sin. Now, after that, then you come to matawbatu min al-dhunub al-sagair. That is nafsul al-lawwam. That a person commits sin and then after that they go and ask Allah for forgiveness. Then you have the third one. At-tawbatu min at-tafakkur. That even thinking about sin, the person goes and do the tawbah. And that is called al-maqam al-nafsul mutma'inna. Not only they don't commit sin, they don't even, when they think about sin, they repent for that as well. Then Imam Ali continued in Dua Kumail. He said, Ya Rabbi Raham Da'afa Badani, Wariqata Jildi, Wadiqata Azmi. Here Imam Ali alayhi salam now present, Ya Allah, if I don't deserve your forgiveness, I am one of the smallest creatures of yours. Which is human being. Wada'afa Badani, we are weak. Allahu Akbar. You want to know how weak we are? Allah stated in the Quran, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. Allah said, we created a human being in weakness. How weak are we? You go to Surah Al-Teen, Allah mentioned, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. Human being, when we were born, we are as weak as we can be. We can't stop or do anything for ourselves. We're depending on others. That's our beginning. Now our end also, if we are to live to see a long life, our end also, we depend on somebody. Now even in the between, when we are strong and healthy and youth, we still cannot get everything done except with the help of others. Aren't we weak? Now that is in terms of our creation. Now in terms of if Allah wants to punish us, who are we to stand in the punishment of Allah? That's why Imam Ali said, Ya Rabbi Irham, Ya Allah, I ask you to have mercy with my weak body. وَرِقَّةَ جِلْدِ and the softness of my skin. This skin that you see, just put a fire next to it and see what happened to it. Just a lighter, turn on the lighter and then put next to your skin and my skin and see what happened. The skin is gone. رَقَّةَ جِلْدِ وَدِقَّةَ عَذْمِ دَقِيق. My bones also are not that strong that they can take your punishment, Ya Allah. Then Imam Ali alayhi salam, he continued that he says, أَفَتُرَاكَ مُعَذِّبِي بِنَارِكَ. Ya Allah, would you punish me with your fire? وَبَعْدَ مَنْ تَوَى قَلْبِي مِنْ مَحْرِفَتِكَ. After I get to know you, my heart got to know you. وَلَهِجَ بِهِ لِسَانِي مِنْ ذِكْرِكَ. And my tongue is also get used to your remembrance. وَاعْتَقَدَهُ ضَمِيرِي مِنْ حُبِّكَ. And my heart turned to be a place that carries your love. Here, brothers and sisters, you know, Imam Ali alayhi salam is talking about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, if you have a part of your heart, have the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are successful. You know, there's a narration about a man who used to sell an oil at the time of the Prophet. But one thing, he was blessed, and that is he had the love for the Holy Prophet. The narration says, anytime, any day he goes to the market to buy something, he will always stop by and look at the face of the Prophet. Every single day. One day he came, as he was passing by, he saw the Prophet, he said salam, and he passed by. After he went, few minutes later he came back. Then the Prophet called him. And he came and he sat down. As he was talking to the Prophet, he said to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, Allah has put your love in my heart. That anytime I see you, anytime my eyes just fall on you, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I feel peace in my heart. And for that matter, I want you to make dua for me. Pray to Allah for me that I always be among those who are in love with you, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet made dua for him. Guess what? 3 days later, the Prophet didn't see him. The Prophet was looking. This man didn't come. The first day, the next day, the third day, the Prophet didn't see him. The Prophet asked his companion. Nobody saw him. The Prophet told his companion, let's go pay him a visit. They went to the store where this man sells his oil. They told the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, this man died 3 days ago. Ya Rasulullah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cried for this man, and he said to the companions, he said, Ishhadu, I want you to bear witness that this servant of Allah is being granted the heaven because of the love of the Prophet that he had. The love of the Prophet, brothers and sisters, is so important. That if a person carries it in your heart, it's so important. But however, it has to have the love of Allah first. And then the love of the Prophet, and then the love of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. And when we say the love of Allah, brothers and sisters, meaning what? Meaning there shouldn't be any other love of anything in your heart except the love of Allah. You know, there is an ayah in the Quran where Allah says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Allah says, every one of you will not be successful on the day of judgment except those who come to Allah with the قَلْبِ السَّلِيمِ. A sound heart. They asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, what is the sound heart? The Prophet said, the heart that there is nothing in it except the love of Allah. Then when somebody asks the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, that means we shouldn't love our spouses? We shouldn't love our children? The Prophet says, yes, of course you have to. But the love of the spouse and the children have to be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I love my wife, I love my children, but I don't love them because of them. I love them because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I love my house, but not because of the house is house. No, because it's the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted me this blessing, and it's the place I live in and prayed in to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that we love, it has to have a link to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah in Surah Al-Baqarah, He said, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And those who believe in Allah, أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. Their love for Allah is much stronger compared to any other love. Now, how do I know that I love Allah the most, more than anything else? Here they said, always test yourself. How do I test myself? Two things comes in your life. Allah said, do it. And your heart said, don't do it. Now, which one are you going to follow? If your heart, by any means, your heart was able to go for Allah's wish, that means the love of Allah in your heart is stronger. But if it's the other way around, I put the Allah's wish aside and I did whatever I want, then the love of Allah is not there. So that is how much. And we can test ourselves in everything, brothers and sisters. Example, Salat al-Fajr. One of the toughest times of Salat. And Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq said, if you want to know our true Shia, he said, look at them at the Fajr prayer. If they wake up for Fajr prayer, that is the sign that they are true servants. They are true Shia. Now for Fajr prayer, you and I, we hear Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, which is Allah is telling you, come, it's time to talk to me. At the same time, my nafs tells me that, no, it's time to relax, you're too tired. You had a long night, long day, you need some rest. Now here there is a battle between the wish of Allah and the wish of myself. Now which one am I going to surrender to? If I say it, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, and woke up and go and stood and pray, that means the love of Allah is stronger. But if I say, no, inshallah, I'll do it later, I then turn off that alarm and went back to sleep and didn't wake up until 9:10:30. That means Allah is not the main love in my heart. The same thing in everything, brother. Halal income is there. I can make thousands of money from this haram. But at the same time, I know Allah said it's haram. Now, which one am I going to listen to? Allah's haram and leaving this haram go, even though I'm going to lose millions of money? Oh no, I have to say, inshallah, I'll take the haram and inshallah, I'll do pay my khums and then you take care of the rest. That is where the battle comes in. In little things, brother, sometimes at work, sometimes at home, you see this test comes in. And you have to choose between the one or the other. And that is how you can tell if you are a true lover of Allah or not. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to develop the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ya Allah, we ask you, let your love be stronger in our heart more than anything else, ya Rabb. And ya Allah, help us to choose what pleases you more than what pleases us, ya Rabbal Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa ajjil farajahum. Allahumma salli ala. Now we go to question and answers for a few minutes if there are any questions. Yes. Yaqub alayhi salam, also they mention in the tafsir that the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested Yaqub alayhi salam with the love of his son Yaqub alayhi salam, he didn't do haram. As we mentioned, the other prophet, none of them did haram. What they did is tark bab al-awla. One of the narrations stated that Yaqub alayhi salam, what he did was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, Ya Yaqub, do not show the love of one son over the others. Even though it's not haram. If you have someone that you love among your children, you have a good reason, you are allowed to show it. But it's preferable not to. But Yaqub alayhi salam, he showed the love of Yusuf alayhi salam over the other 10 children. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him in the same Yusuf alayhi salam by taking Yusuf alayhi salam away from him. And then he has to pay the price of crying for not having Yusuf alayhi salam for 40 years. I'm not interested. 40 years he has to cry until his sight was gone. And Quran mentioned, he said, وَبِيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ فَهُوَ قَظِيمٌ. He became blind from the crying of separation from his son. Because Yaqub alayhi salam, he had a special love for Yusuf alayhi salam, more than you can imagine. And when you go to the Quran also mentioned, even when they brought the shirt of Yusuf, shirt, as soon as his children arrived the house, before they enter in the room where Yaqub was, Yaqub could sense and feel the smell of Yusuf alayhi salam. And Quran mentioned, he said, Inni la ajidu riha Yusuf. He said, I can smell Yusuf from every part of my body. He has a special love and bond with Yusuf alayhi salam. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him with Yusuf alayhi salam as well. The question is there any time one shouldn't offer a namaz or prayer or dua? Now, let's start with dua. Dua is 24/7. Anytime, any place, one is allowed to ask Allah and pray to Allah. There's no time or there's no any special place that or time that you shouldn't pray to Allah. However, we have some time are better than the others. Some places are better than the others. We have this too in Islam. That if you want to make dua, if you are in certain places, your dua is most likely to accept it than the other places. That is number one. Number two, certain time also plays a role in your dua being accepted better than the other time. For example, they say one of the best times that Allah accepts the dua is when the adhan is being called. Unfortunately now, when the adhan is called, that is the time that we chant. Right? You see time the voice is going on, we're talking much. This is the time the door of Allah is open. If you ask Allah at the time of adhan, you are 99.9 chances of acceptance. That's number one. Number two, when there is rain coming down, the rain is a rahmah of Allah. At that moment, the doors of Allah is open. Ask Allah and Allah will accept you. You are most likely to be accepted than any other time. That's number two. Number three, when you are in the state of crying for the sake of Allah, by chance, you remember a sin or something happened, you started crying, at that moment, your heart is now open to the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that moment, it's the best time to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have 99.9 chance of being accepted by Allah. That is number three. Number four, there's one of the best time of Allah accepting your dua is at the night when people are asleep. As Salat al-Layl. When people are asleep, nobody is listening. Just between you and Allah. That is the best time as well. To ask Allah and Allah will accept you. That is the dua. And there are many places and many times as well. But now for Salat also, one can pray at any time as well. But there are certain times are recommended not to or to pray. For example, it depends on the Salat. Like Salat al-Layl, like the night prayer, which is mustahab. They say if a person misses Salat al-Layl, the best time to pray it is during the daytime. Not the night. For example, the last night, Salat al-Layl, I didn't perform it. Now, I want to do qada of Salatul Layl. They say the best time is during the noon time, during the daytime. That's the best time. But other than that, in his wajib salat, one miss, the best time is the time that they get, the sooner they, the earlier they get a chance, the best time to do their prayers. So salat can be performed at any time as you wish, except if the salat time has not set in, then I cannot perform it. Like I cannot say, because tomorrow I'm going out of the town, so inshallah I'm going to do my Fajr, Zuhur, Asr, Maghrib prayer for tomorrow, today, so that I don't have to worry about it tomorrow. No, you can't do that. Inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta. It has to be observed according to the timing that is mentioned or prescribed by Allah. Which one? The question is, one of the companions of the Prophet called Uwais that happened to live at the time of the Prophet, and he used to live in Yemen, but never come at the time of the Prophet and fought with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he did came after Imam Ali, during the time of Imam Ali alayhi salam. Some narration, they analyzed that one of the reason why he didn't came because his situation of that time was very tough, that he couldn't afford to even come to Medina and meet the Prophet. That is some of the scholars. Some say no, that was not the reason. What happened to him was that he wanted to come and meet the Prophet because it's a privilege of every mu'min to come and see the Prophet, live with the Prophet like some companions did, like Salman al-Farisi, who took a lot of trouble in order to come to Medina and meet with the Prophet and live with the Prophet. They said he wanted to come, but there were some enemies who didn't let him to leave Yemen to come to the Prophet. So there are some analyses, some different narrations from the different narrators that he has, at the end of the day, the bottom line is he has a good excuse that he didn't come. That is why Imam Ali accepted him, because if he hadn't had any good excuse, Imam Ali alayhi salam would have not accepted him. So at the end, they say he has a good excuse. That's why he didn't show up at the time of the Prophet. Yes. Yes, sister.
You said, you know, the time of Ramadan is the best time for dua.
Yes.
So if we are reading Quran at that time, do we have to stop it and repeat the azan or make dua at that time?
The question is, it's a good question, because there are two recommendations here during the time of azan. One is either to do the dua or to repeat the azan as well. Now, if a person reading Quran at the time and then the adhan start, should we stop the adhan? Should we stop the reading Quran or continue the Quran, or should we repeat the adhan, or should we do dua? Which one of them? Now, the answer is, if a person can pause the Quran at that point, then the person should pause the Quran. And then after that, the person can also repeat the adhan and do dua at the same time. Because when the muadhin says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, now while he's reading, I have some time to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certain things. Now after he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, I have enough time to say my dua and then repeat what he says. So the best thing is, you can repeat so you get the thawab of repeating the adhan and then doing the dua at the same time. Yes. Yes, sister. Alaykum as-salam. Which one? Salat al-Layl? The question is, Salat al-Layl, when a person performs Salat al-Layl, and then, like, let's say the time of Fajr also comes, but it's still dark. Is that right? So, should the person continue the Salat al-Layl, or no, they have to pause and do the Salat of Fajr? The answer is that Salat al-Layl is mustahab. It's recommended in Islam. It's highly recommended. But it was wajib for our Prophet. Our Prophet, it was wajib that he has to do 6 daily prayers and we get 1 discount. We do 5, he needs to do 6. Now, for us, as the Salat al-Layl is mustahab, they said you are allowed to do the Salat until the time of Fajr prayer sets in. When the Fajr Salat sets in, then you are not allowed to continue of mustahab when the time of wajib comes in. Because wajib takes priority over mustahab. I can't pay attention to mustahab when the wajib time is in. No. So the point is, if the time of Maghrib comes in, the time of Fajr comes in, I have to pause my Salat al-Layl and do my Salat al-Fajr, and then after that, the rest of them, I can do them qada. You can do that. Or you can just pause Salat al-Layl there, or Salat al-Layl by itself. If you look, there is no enough time to perform all the 11 rak'ah, you can short it to 3 rak'ah, which is rak'ah til witr and then shafa, a shaf and witr, which is 2 rak'ah of witr and then 1 al-witr, and then you also get like the Salat al-Layl, and then you can go and do the Salat al-Fajr at the same time. So depending on the time, but if you have enough time, then you can cover them all together. Yes, it doesn't matter. As soon as the time of the Fajr sets in, that's it. We have to stop the Salat al-Layl and pay attention to the Salat al-Fajr. Yes. Yes. That's right. If the time of the recent prayer start in, then the previous Salat becomes qada at that point. So if the time of Fajr enters and I'm not done with the Salat al-Layl, then my Salat al-Layl becomes qada after that. And I can wait after Fajr prayer, I can do the rest or do the whole Salat al-Layl or do the part that I missed before the Fajr came in. Yes. Good question. That when we ask Allah for repentance, how do we know that Allah accepted our tawbah? Now, here our scholars, they mention something. They say we have al-ma'asiyah ba'dal at-ta'ah. One. And then we have at-ta'atu ba'dal ma'asiyah. And then we have al-ma'asiyah ba'dal ma'asiyah. 4 situations, 4 categories. Number one. A person commits sin, and then after a sin, he commits another sin. Meaning like sins after a sin. They say that is a sign of the person is going towards the wrong direction. It's like somebody is sinking. If I find myself, I commit a sin, and then another sin, and another sin. Sin after the other, that is I'm sinking. I have to watch out for myself. That is number one. Number two, they say a person al-ma'asiyah ba'da ta'ah. I committed something, obedience, I did my salat, and right after that, I committed a sin. That is not a good sign. Now, the other way around, I committed a sin, and then after that, I started to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a good thing. Now, they said here, after I ask Allah's forgiveness, right? Now, I have to watch myself that everything that I do, I have to make sure that it doesn't become something as I used to, which is sin. So, if after the tawbah, I found myself, I became a better servant. Meaning, things I used to do, now I don't do them. The bad things. That is the sign that your tawbah is accepted. Meaning, for example, let's say before that, I used to commit 5, 10, 15 sins every day. But after tawbah, now I commit, let's say, 3 or 4. That means my tawbah is accepted. That is one of the main signs of my tawbah is accepted or not. Yes. Yes, sister. Yes. Yes, the question is, if you're doing qada salat, and then the wajib salat comes in, do you have to do another qada of that salat, or what should you do? No, if you're doing your qada salat, salat that the time has passed, because, you know, we have three different types of salat. There is qada, every salat has three times. There is one is called waqtul fadila. That is the best time for every salat, and that is as soon as the time of any salat sets in, you pray at that time. That is the best. It's called waqtul fadila. Number two is called waqtul ada, meaning the period of where the salat can be performed. Now, after that time of the salat is over and the next salat time set in, then the previous salat is called qada. Now, that's three. So we have waqtul fadila, waqtul ada, and waqtul qada. Now, if I'm performing qada, salat that the time has passed, and then the salat, another wajib salat time comes in, right? Now, if I know I have enough time for that salat ada, then I can finish my qada and then perform that ada salat. But if I have only qada prayer, the salat that the time already passed, but now the salat that I have to do, which is wajib now, I only have short time that if I don't perform that salat in that period of time, that salat also becomes qada. Then I have to pause that the previous qada and do the ada. Because you don't want to lose this one, so it becomes qada too. No, so this one is already alone, you already owe Allah. So go ahead and do this, which is the time is still now in, where I can get the thawab of ada. And then after that, you can continue the qada.
What if you have time to perform the
No, you don't have to. Yeah, so long as you do, the question is, if I do my qada prayer and then the next salat time sets in, do I have to repeat the qada of that previous salat? No. As long as it's done properly, correctly, that's it. So you just move on with the next salat and you don't have to repeat that again. Yes, please. Yes, please.
Yes.
the two questions, brother, is asking, number one is, what was the crime of Prophet Yunus alayhi salam that he did, that he called himself min al-zalimin, inni kuntu min al-zalimin? Like I mentioned, Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, he's not the only one who called himself zalim. Prophet Adam alayhi salam also said, inni zalamna anfusana, we have did zulm to ourselves. Now quickly, what is the meaning of dhulum? A dhulum in Arabic is to not to put things where they belong to. I have things. Every one of them belong to a specific place. Now if I misplace them, then it's called dhulum in Arabic, literally. But in Sharia, when we say a dhulum is to do injustice to somebody. Now, going back to Sulaiman, Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, the justice that he's referring is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him to the people of Iraq. Allah didn't ask him to leave the people. He didn't get the revelation to leave, but he lived anyway. Now, the dhulm that he did was that he shouldn't have left before the revelation of Allah comes to him. Meaning, he didn't put things where they're supposed to be. Meaning, it shouldn't have stayed there until Allah tells him to leave. Like the people of Lut alayhi salam. Lut alayhi salam, he was among his people. Many years they were committing this crime. But he didn't leave the city. Until Allah said to him, leave you and your people. Now the punishment of Allah is coming. Now that is what Yunus didn't do. And that is what he calls a dhulm to himself. Because he should have stayed there until the command of Allah comes in. The Mufassirin said, the reason why he left, because he sensed the punishment of Allah is coming. So he thought he has to leave. That's why he left. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell him to leave at that point. And that itself in his level is considered dhulm to himself. Injustice to himself. That is why he said, "Zalam inni kuntu min al-zalimin," meaning I have done injustice to myself by leaving the city before your revelation came. That is for Yunus alayhi salam. Now the next one is the question about doing dua during the time of majlis. Now at the time of majlis, when we are crying for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. But crying for Ahlul Bayt also is crying for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is also highly recommended at that time for one can make dua as well if you want to. Right? But if somebody chooses to make dua after the majlis, that is fine too. There is no objection. I can wait after the crying is finished and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is fine. But the preference according to the hadith is during the time of crying is better. Yes. Wow. Yeah. Yes, go ahead, please. Yes, brother saying that I don't want to think about myself when I'm crying for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That is fine. One can think about just Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam at the moment. When you cry for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, yes, you're crying for them because it's the tragedy is about them at that point. But Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam also, they will not bother if you take a moment to think about yourself. Because Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they are so generous that even when you think about them, they would mind if you take a moment to make dua for yourself. And also especially, brother, dua, it doesn't have to be just for yourself. No. At that moment when I'm crying about Ahlul Bayt, I can make dua for other people who are going through tragedy too. I can make dua for other mu'mineen as well. So it's not just about me. that maybe at that moment I say, Ya Allah, give me. No, I can think about the others, and that is much rewarded than thinking about self. So even at that moment, one can think about that. That is number one. Number two, even at the time of the crying for Ahlul Bayt, one can make dua for Ahlul Bayt too. That's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to elevate their level, their maqam, higher and higher as well. That is also something one can do as well. So if there is many things we can do at the time of the crying, even though the cry is for Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, one is for some mu'mineen as well who are sick, who are going through tragedies. Some one of them also is for the Ahlul Bayt themselves during the time of crying. And also on top of that, as we mentioned, one can wait after dua and make dua for themselves or for other people as well. Yes. Inshallah, I think we go for the dua. Inshallah, together to Al-Faraj. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا